Thomas, welcome. Nanti, one of the largest and biggest impulse collectors.
Good evening.
Nice to have you with us. Yeah, that was nice, calm, beautiful, dark. What have we listened to? Duke Ellington, John Coltrane, of course. I think when we talk about impulse label, it will be difficult to not talk about John Coltrane. And it will be even more difficult to stop Stanley from saying that he is not a big John Coltrane.
There's no reason for that. But you know the nickname of the impulse label?
No, tell us.
The house that John Coltrane built.
Okay. I knew that, but that was not a nickname. That was more of a subline. Okay. Then Santi, when you start with this, tell us the background. Why do people say that? Why does Impulse have this nickname?
Because I guess no other jazz label has been as strongly identified with one artist. That's kind of. When you think of John Coltrane, apart from some snobs, they think black and orange.
Right. But isn't it also true that Coltrane had real shares at the label? He was a shareholder, wasn't he?
I don't know about that, Thomas.
I think I've heard that.
He had part of it.
I know he had a very special and unique contract with them that a lot of all the jazzmen were jealous of. Was it shares? Maybe if you say so, then that explains a lot. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Maybe that even made that he had shares, at least that he was the main figure on the label. I think we will get into that record later, I can imagine. Made Love Supreme possible, right? I can imagine that the label was more fond of titles like Ballads than Love Supreme at the beginning.
Sure. I don't think anyone would have objected to Love Supreme, though.
Blue Note? You don't think so?
No, I don't think so. Mm-hmm. I think they would have objected maybe to Ascension, but not to Love Supreme.
Thomas, what's your take on the Impulse label? I don't ask when you get aware of it. I think that was quite early. But when did you start collecting? What was the reason to start it for you?
I think when you have a Impulse records in your hand, you feel like this is how a record should be made.
Mm-hmm.
Wherever you go out looking for records, when you get an Impulse, you get happy. And if you get one in a high quality, it's amazing to even not without hearing it. And I think the artwork, everything is the highest quality. When you found them many years ago, they didn't cost much. And today it's maybe 20 records that are expensive, but the rest is between 10 and 50 euro.
No, that's which is amazing. I agree. For me, the first time I got aware of the label was when I saw, I don't know, in the video, this stack of Impulse in a shelf, the orange and the black.
But yeah.
This is nothing but wonderful, in my opinion. I so like it, and I'm quite anal and nerdy about it. What I hate that sometimes the orange is a little bit off color, and that sometimes the orange part is a little longer and shorter. I so hate this.
Michael, I think because we have a friend who really loves Impulse as well, I think you maybe want to say something.
Dave is at the hospital right now. And what Kevin said is absolutely right. We wish him a very, very speedy recovery. And our thoughts are, of course, with his family. And I can't wait. And I pray to whomever that he will be back with us soon. Okay. Impulse. The spine, exactly. But the spine is not the reason you get into...
No.
Right? What is your take on the Impulse label, Santi?
Well, my take... people who follow me, I'm not like the biggest John Coltrane fan, but I like some of it. It's just that there is a cult of personality almost around him, and probably deservingly so. For me, Impulse is even more the label of Bob Thiel, who was the art director of the label almost from the beginning. He was not the creator of the label, but he was hired right away because the guy who created it, he instantly moved to MGM or something.
Okay.
And Bob Thiel was he was a songwriter, an arranger, and all. He wrote "What a Wonderful World" for Louis Armstrong. So he has some credits already. He did that maybe even I don't remember when he did that, but he had a very, very strong art direction, and I guess that. That's probably the label also that kind of, in a way, you could say that it influenced techno in the sense that when you bought an Impulse record, it was probably the first label that I can think of that had such a distinctive design that you would see it's an Impulse record way before you saw which artist it was, as you said, Michael, with the theme, but also the cover. Big logo on the cover with three colors, black, white, and orange, so very popping. And that's marketing, obviously. But the reason we remember them is because of the quality. So the marketing helped establish it, of course.
The quality helped keeping it at top.
And so that you had to have someone.
Look, Thomas says. So that people who are not so familiar see that's what I'm talking. This is perfect. This is perfect.
But it's not, Michael, because it's not the same height. You see, like the black, it's really fucking up with your OCD.
And Thomas not keeping them straight even makes it worse. but come on, Santi. Impulse is not only Coltrane. It's also, for me, it's Pharoah Sanders, it's Alice Coltrane, and two blue spines.
Well, you just named two names. But when you say Pharoah Sanders and Alice Coltrane, they are on Impulse because of Coltrane.
Yeah, absolutely.
So.
Yeah, but come on, still we can connect the label to those artists too, right?
Sure. But... and there's others who have nothing to do with Coltrane as well that are great there, absolutely.
And some surprising records we might get into a little later. Thomas, have you prepared another song for us yet, or shall we wait a little?
But again, I think that. And we'll show that throughout our discussion tonight, hopefully. Maybe that's one thing that we help some shed light to, that like the real secret weapon of Impulse, at least up until 1968, is Bob Thiele, who had just impeccable art direction and intuition. Like, as you say, maybe it was not that easy to do a Love Supreme. It makes sense to do it, but you might be right. Maybe it was more complicated than I assume.
That's true. Yeah. Charles Mingus is unbelievable at Impulse. I totally agree. Those are amazing records. Yeah, totally true.
And also, I think that the Impulse label is not just important for the music it released back then, but how also the music was reintroduced to different generations through different formats, different technologies. And I remember in the 90s, there was a huge John Coltrane reissue program on Impulse. Mm. CD.
We go into reissues, of course, when it comes to Impulse, but let us get us some tunes.
But what I just wanted to say is that at one point, they also introduced a lot of unreleased sessions from the time.
Yes.
So it's kind of the label, if you like them.
One of those has been the record of the year recently, I think 5 years ago.
Yeah. So it's a label that still has some surprise.
Angela. Okay, let's listen. What are we listening to, Thomas?
I think we are a trip back to when it started in 1962. Yeah. And this was one of the first releases. It was release number 2. And it was Ray Charles.
Genius and Soul equals Jazz. Yeah.
Arranged by Quincy Jones. You can see you have the string orchestra in the back.
This is an amazing album. I totally agree. And I think the original of it is not that expensive. Am I correct?
No, this is the reason why Impulse got a huge success, because the release number 2 was a huge success. So they sold a lot of copies and they made a lot of money from the first issue. So it's not a rare record. It's often beaten up, but it's not a rare record.
Yeah. We get into that when we talk about Love Supreme.
Maybe you can find one for 5 to 20 euro. Okay, copy of this one. It's but it was when they started, and I'll just show you because this is number 2. You can see it has a number. Yeah,
A2, right? Mm-hmm.
So mono and A is the same as mono. If you say AS2, it would be the stereo version.
Ah, okay, interesting. So A stands for mono.
Yeah, AS for stereo.
Okay.
Yeah, and a lot of the time they mess it up, but that's the rule.
Is that true, Stunty or Thomas? Is this the only Ray Charles on Impulse?
It is. Yeah.
It is.
And it's in a way, when we were saying that John Coltrane. That Impulse is the house that John Coltrane built, with a lot of help from that record.
Thomas. When you, I think it was gone away. Thomas said that this one, the second release, was a huge success.
Yeah, but it was. It's not just that it was a success; it was a planned success. They knew what they were doing. It was it was like, let's get Ray Charles that year. Like, that was like a done deal. Like, they knew. Basically, it's almost like they did a favor to Impulse so that they could buy their freedom in a way for at least a little while.
Okay, so that's interesting. But was that out of pure kindness of them, or
again,
I don't believe in those things when it comes to the music business.
Well, because Impulse is not an independent label,
mm-hmm.
So it was part of a large conglomerate of labels. So at one point, you try to find the right way to launch a label as well.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I can just say that release number one, you can see up there. Mono A1.
I didn't know this record, by the way. Is it the most famous part of it? Is it because it's number one? Because I don't know this record.
Yeah.
To be honest.
You can see that it has Bill Evans.
Yeah, Chambers, Roy Haynes, Art Taylor. I mean, yeah.
But it's not one of the best records. I can't even remember it. I don't listen to it.
Okay. So I think Stunty is at the telephone. No problem. So you have more than one copy. What a surprise!
Yeah, because I just told you that Stereo will be AS, but
okay. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
They already messed it up in the beginning because Stereo A1, but they got into the system after 2-3 records.
Nice. Okay. So, but I think having the very, very first Impulse is a nice thing. I mean, that's something special.
I don't agree 100%.
You don't, okay.
The way I collect most labels, if there's a new label for me I want to get into, I start with number one. Listen, what was the first one? Then I go to number two.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And all that, like on Impulse, there's 350 releases.
Yeah.
I put in my want list like 20, the first 20 that I want. And for me, the best one came in 72, 73. And that was like 300 releases later.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. When it comes to the release, Lovell Andrew has a wonderful channel. He said that A7 is the beginning of the heavy hitters. Can you comment on that? Which record is A7?
I think he already know me because I know A7 more than I know the artist.
Let's have a look at A7. The start. Do you know that out of your head, Stunty, what A7 is?
No. I know what A15 is.
Okay.
But.
Okay. Here we have Art Blakey. Of course, a heavy hitter, no doubt.
Yeah.
And the Jazz Messengers. How came that to be, Stunty? You know that, the background story?
Yeah. I know, but. Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers never did it to me, so it's sorry.
And I would say they never did a bad record, but that's not true. But I like Art Blakey.
Yeah, I mean Art Blakey is legend. I mean, no discussion about this.
But when Thomas says it starts in the 70s, I'm sure he will contradict himself a few times because there are quite a few before the 70. Like for me, this one, the A15, which is a record that is still fairly easy to find. And that's one of the things also, because they're so thick, they're like tanks, like you often find them in pretty good shape,
mm-hmm.
if not mm-hmm. excellent. This mm-hmm. Max Roach record for me is the beginning. It's when Max Roach becomes really his own man, when he does solo or albums in as a leader, obviously, because he doesn't do solo, that are like, okay, now he broke free from his leaders, his influences, and the seeds of the stuff to come with the M Boom percussion band are already there. So it's not completely free, but it's more than just modern jazz. Mm-hmm. And well, it's I would say it's very good record to get into free jazz with, actually.
Okay.
And, and you get
you get the blessing of Marcella Stanti when it comes to this record.
Yeah, well, you got Mal Waldron, Julian Priester, Clifford Jordan. I mean,
that's yeah. Stanti, you get encouragement from the gallery.
What is your favorite track on it?
You know, normally I don't think that way for these kind of records, but
I really
like Lonesome Lover on it, the last one. But I really like it all on it. But Lonesome Lover would be the one that right now I would listen to if I would choose one.
Oh, it's gorgeous, right?
Hear me, love, my heart is beating.
Take me back where I belong.
I know folks are saying from you I've been straight, but still I keep praying.
This is a recording that you can feel the Bob Keel touch behind. Like this kind of arrangement and ensemble is the kind of stuff he was really pushing for.
Okay, Stanti, then get a little bit deeper into it, because art director.
Yeah.
And then?
Well, an art director, he says yes and no to this or this recording or this project. Mm-hmm. This kind of like big band that veers into spiritual jazz, that is really something that if you look at his pedigree, at the stuff that he pushed, that's really the kind of stuff I identify him with as well. Mm-hmm. There's not really that many records like that back then. Like, what year is that? Like 62, Thomas?
I don't know that.
Or even before.
This is 62.
62, yeah.
By the way, Thomas, we have two wishes so far. Hey Joe wants to have A5, and Lovell also said we should check out A8. 5 and 8. Stanti, what are 5 and 8?
I don't remember.
We, of course, will get into spiritual jazz when it comes to the Impulse label. Marius, you're driving with your car? Careful. Just listen. Don't watch.
We'll also go a little beyond Impulse.
Yeah. So we have here Max Roach.
It's also number,
which number is that? That's the A8, okay. Percussion. You know that one, Stanti?
Yeah. It's a good one.
Okay. Then let me ask something. A7, A15. How many records did they put out? Did they have the same output as Blue Note? Probably not, right?
No.
They did. I thought so.
Oliver
Nelson, Louis, of course. Oh, let's hear something from it. Of course. I mean, hey.
It's that's number 5.
Okay. Hey, Joe, great choice. Yeah, wonderful record.
It comes with the rare cover as well.
So this is the rare one? And yeah. The other one?
Half rare. It's a good record. It's not a cheap record.
And so explain to me, Thomas, they did two from the beginning, or why are there two different jackets?
I actually don't know.
Okay.
I just found out one day that this is
one is rare,
and people really wanted this one because I had one up for sale of this.
It's just a theory, but the label Impulse was one of these labels that was really listening to their artist. So it might be that the artist requested to have another, that he didn't like the cover, and he was. Because they did that a few times.
I think it was opposite, because if you look at the first one, it says Oliver Nelson, and if you look at the second one, he's down at the third place. So I think it might have something to do with that. But
so, hey, Joe is asking for Stolen Moments.
Well, you can't get everything you want in life, huh?
You need a number.
But we can play something from Blues and the Apps.
I just saw one thing that I think it's worth getting. I used to have all my Impulse in the normal heavy plastic covers, but you couldn't see the end of it properly. But with those new sleeves, you can read the titles.
So I really like that. That's one of the most beautiful aspects and effects of them. That you, when you have sleeved them and you put them in the shelf, The record is still one record with those general where you put them you always have this and you can't read it anymore. It's not so defined anymore. It's just an whatever.
Yeah. With those new sleeves, you can look at the shelf and just see, this is the one. You can read it. Before I took everything to find.
Okay.
There's one little thing I think should be good to tackle. I don't know if Thomas has any or has prepared any, but in the early years of Impulse, they were also doing a lot of 7-inches.
Were they?
Singles of the albums, like the Roy Haynes, the Ray Charles, and even Max Roach had like 7-inches. I've seen them a few times. So you have... and you don't have like picture seal leaves for them. You just have like the.
It's just a white sheet.
Yeah.
So the idea behind it was jukebox, or was it DJing, or what was the idea behind it?
People were buying them. It was they were doing them. They're not rare. Like you find them not quite easily, but. It was not just for the jukebox. It was. I'm not sure that. It was in 61, 62, so there was still a market for jazz in jukebox, I guess. Yeah. Because by 63, they don't do that anymore. Or not as much, at least.
We often see the 7-inches. We have a lot of them, but I need to find a number to go out and see where it is on the shelf. And the problem is like Impulse is like 4,000 releases when you need to go into Discogs to look it up. So
what?
You need to scroll through.
Yeah, Impulse, but it's 4,000 releases.
with the different pressings.
Okay. That makes sense.
I can tell you how many there are around.
How many?
But now that I look quickly, yeah, they did a lot of these for the jukebox in up until like 63.
Okay, thanks for looking it up. Concerning the OBC shop, every record you see behind Thomas is at the OBC, will come to the OBC, and later on Thomas will also show some records that will be put up there. So there will be around 50 Impulse releases at the OBC shop, most of them first pressing. Thomas is looking for some numbers.
What's easy and what I like with the Impulse is that they have a system for the numbers. And they start with number A1 and then they end up with number 100 here.
Okay. A100. Okay.
Yeah. From that point, they jumped to 9,100.
Okay. Okay, they just make a 9,000. Okay.
Yep.
Yeah, they made it 9,100, and then they continued the number for 9,100 up to 9,343, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So, if you put it together, there's the whole first 100, and then there's another 200, like 350 releases around there.
350, okay. So, how many Blue Notes do we have?
Double,
huh? Yeah. And then Verve doubles Blue Note, right? At least.
Triple impulse. Maybe double Blue Note. And then we have Columbia. Three double. Verb.
And then we have Nurse with Wound. Oh my God.
And yeah.
So, when Stunty? When did this spiritual jazz start? With the Love Supreme? Earlier? Later? Would you accept that Love Supreme is spiritual jazz?
No. Actually, no. For me, it's a very big influence, but for me, spiritual jazz arrives later.
Yeah, but it sounds like a spiritual jazz release to me. And now? Does that make me an idiot?
No. There's a connection, but spiritual jazz is, for me, is coming from free jazz. So it's like there's a step between, like, the traditional stuff we're talking about, that is modern jazz, post swing, post bop. To have spiritual jazz, you have to go through to the beginning of free jazz before. And I think, there's something, you could say there's something spiritual about that music, but like if it's the genre that has been kind of codified, is the, you know, it's the grandfather.
Yeah. Okay. So we will get deeper into it, because I can imagine that we will listen to quite some in my opinion, spiritual jazz records. And Thomas has prepared something, I think.
Yeah, I just saw somebody said a comment, because this is spiritual jazz.
Yeah. And let me get into it, because this also will be a part of today's show. Karma. And the Alice Coltrane that are part of the Acoustic Sound series here in Germany/Europe, those are the best-selling titles. It's not Love Supreme. It's not Blues and the Abstract Truth. It's not. Those two here in Europe. And I'm almost under the impression that the spiritual jazz is a little bit more a European thing than an American thing. Wonderful record. When again, because I can imagine that a lot of people are interested in an original of this one. What do I have to invest when I want a pristine, a very good copy of this record? And no, I don't ask Stanti, then it would be a 10 euro record, but realistic.
No, I would tell you 65, between 65 and 80 if you want a real good copy of that.
And now, Thomas?
If you're very patient, because the cheapest one you can find on the internet is, I think, like 160.
That was so difficult, Stanti.
So bring all the 65-euro karma to me. I'll buy them all.
Exactly, we buy every 65-euro karma in a decent shape. Every.
No, but I agree. I also know where I can get a copy in Stockholm.
Of course, if you look for a long time or know where to look or somebody will sell it without a receipt, or then you can change with the prices.
But it's
a record that was $50 just 3-4 years ago before he died.
Yeah, and that's what I'm thinking of.
Yeah. So after he's dead, you won't find any Pharoah Sanders cheap records.
Yeah, that record, I bought it 20 years ago, and last summer I had someone with me who bought it. It was exactly like you said, before he died, and it was still like I said 65, but I thought 50 in my mind, because most desirable Impulse records are worth about $50 in good shape, and there are the ones that are more expensive and the ones that are much less expensive, but
shall we listen to a little karma? Is that okay with you, Thomas?
I prepared another one with Pharoah Sanders.
We go with your flow. Sorry.
That's no problem.
One is spiritual jazz for sure.
Yeah. Do you know which year, Stanti? Do you know that?
66, 67, 68. Thomas will tell us. You, Michael, you know why he's called Pharoah Sanders, right?
No, tell me. And if I knew, I would also say no, tell me, because some people might be interested.
Well, take a wild guess. It's another musician who named him that way.
Coltrane.
Who could it be?
Coltrane.
No. Second guess?
Second guess.
It's quite logical when you think about it. Someone you've had on your channel quite a few times would guess instantly, or would say instantly.
Sun Ra?
Yeah.
Yeah.
See? I like that answer too, by the way. This stuff also. Any background behind it, Stunty? Why did you gave him the name? How did that came to be?
I don't remember exactly, but I think he had a name. I don't remember, but like, he was basically Christian's Pharaoh Sanders. I think he was looking for a name or something, and like Sunra like made it like almost like dictatorially.
His name was Pharaoh as well, so Pharaoh.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Billy Boy.
So it was just phonetic. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that record for years was like, it was not a record that was very famous, but like people who were into that kind of music, that was kind of like a, you know, cornerstone for.
Okay.
Even more so than the other one that you wanted.
The Karma.
Yeah.
This is wonderful. I mean, so this is also is that before or after Karma? Because I didn't know the first one we are listening to. Is that before or after Karma?
It was this one was before Karma. Karma was first.
Okay, and then this one.
No, and then came this one.
Okay.
This one is less talked about.
And then came this one.
Mm-hmm.
And then came this one.
You have a favorite, Thomas?
Yes. And then came this one.
Okay.
And then he put out this one.
You have them all, it's unbelievable.
And then he put out this one.
Okay.
And then he put out this one.
All on Impulse, yeah?
This is all Impulse.
Okay. Loving that. Oh, this is an amazing cover art.
And then there's a best of. That was the record he put on the Impulse.
Wonderful. Thanks for sharing it though.
I think it was 10 records.
You have a favorite, Thomas, amongst those?
My favorite?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Second favorite,
mm-hmm.
Third favorite.
It's almost like that came out. So he got weak. So Pharaoh Sanders got weaker and weaker.
Oh, but then I jumped to like this one.
Okay. Yeah, the jacket alone. Yeah.
But I think all his releases is worth collecting. I don't know, but this one I can't remember. It's the compilation. It's
okay. Fanti, your take on Pharaoh Sanders?
I am pretty much on the same page as Thomas. Pembe is my favorite of, but like, I think he did some wonderful stuff after the Impulse years, like stuff that is better than most of the Impulse catalog, actually.
Do you have Impulse releases of Pharaoh Sanders? You have some of those?
I had Tembi, I had Karma, but I think I gave it to someone thinking that I would find it again. but to be honest, I've listened to it so much, I don't feel a need. I feel closer. For me, this one is more important to me.
Mm-hmm. The music of Juju, Archie Shepp. But that's not Pharaoh Sanders.
No, but I'm saying that, like, because they are very connected. They are both associated in the same way. But this one for me is one I don't get tired of.
Okay.
And.
Is that Impulse 2?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, this is Impulse 2, okay.
Yeah. It's Bob Teal production as always, and Yeah, that one was desirable for a long time, and if we did find it for 40-50 bucks for the longest time, I think it's these days are long gone now.
So now it's 20 bucks or
no, but it's, I think a lot of it is also because of what we talked briefly about at the beginning of the stream, which is how a lot of people discovered all of this with the reissues that you bought.
Yeah.
So, and thanks to you, or because of you, and or us, to a small degree, that when when we're blah blah blahing about like get the originals, there's good reasons. Well, before you get the original, like you discover this for the reissues, you love it, and like, okay, maybe I need an original of that actually. And and I mean, discover, come on. Like,
brilliant. Also, it could looks like a soundtrack, the stream we had last week. Oh, Thomas has it too. Thomas has it too.
How high do you rate that one, Thomas?
I would say for me, it's also in top 10, 15. It's
okay. That's without,
without knowing which one is number one.
Yeah.
Can you give us a listen of it? A few seconds of the record?
Can I see which pressing you have, Thomas, in the upper corner? Oh, okay, that's okay, yeah. Yeah, we have the same one then. It's because you have the French distribution, okay, yeah. Yeah.
Who else is playing on that record? Don't you? You know that far off your head? Oh, you have the record there, you can see.
No, but it's Reggie Workman, Beaver Harris, who else? Dennis Charles, Martin Banks, I think. Yeah. Ed Blackwell, yeah.
Nice. So quite sad.
See how it starts like a really a modern jazz. It sounds like like a blue note from like 63.
Exactly. Yeah, no, it goes on. Yeah. Very interesting. Yeah.
And it used to be like a 30, 40, 50 euro record. But I saw one at a record fair 2 months ago, and near mint. I think, okay, I'll upgrade it. And he wanted 400 euro for it.
Okay. Okay.
I love the way that Thomas said it. It used to be a 40-50. When I bought this, it was a 40-50, but it was a lot of money for me back then.
40-50 was a lot of money for this one because it was not a known one on the one people on.
And in the last years it went up like that. 405. Wow. Will we see a spare copy at the OBC shop, Thomas? You have a spare copy of it?
I haven't found. No, I don't think I have one.
Okay.
But I think it's a lot to do with Alice Coltrane. I think I can't remember why, but in 4 or 5 years ago, everybody knew Alice Coltrane.
Yeah.
And maybe it was in some movies or commercials, but everybody knew Alice Coltrane, and everybody wanted to get into like spiritual thing. And then people went into Sun Ra and Pharoah Sanders, and then they went into Coltrane as well. But I don't see Coltrane as spiritual jazz. He's more like free jazz. Yeah. And they got scared because everybody think they love Coltrane, but a lot of people get scared when they hear Coltrane stuff. But when I play the first one to the other, the Duke Ellington, that's like a Coltrane everybody loves.
Yes, yes.
But the spiritual thing, except from it doesn't hurt anybody.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Like this, people will often say, "Oh, that's weird."
Mm-hmm.
But the more you get into it, yeah.
Is it safe to say that Impulse brought spiritual jazz to us, or has there been labels at the same time period or even earlier, or is this a bit of an Impulse thing, at least for the broader mass of people?
I think for me, Impulse was the first time that it got more mainstream. Maybe not the first time, but it was there way before.
Yeah, because as you said it earlier, Michael, like spiritual jazz in a way is more of a European thing originally. Like it's American musicians who really brought it, but like the labels, like you find labels in France, in Germany, in Denmark, in Holland, in Italy, as soon as like 64, 65, releasing music that I would say is spiritual jazz. And there will be some exceptions, like some private labels in the US. Spiritual jazz often is, like the typical spiritual jazz is a private press, private label, black and white cover, and at least in the US.
Okay. But when it comes to a larger audience, it's safe to say it's Impulse.
I don't, maybe. It's, sorry.
Savoy ESP is also had just, okay, thanks. The Savoy label, yeah, also a very interesting label, ESP, yes. Very interesting.
But because Impulse is also a label of tons of stuff like that, which is, this is good. It's not like, I mean, you got Kenny Burrell there, but like it's Terry Gibbs vibes.
You say, that's something not so good. There's Kenny Burrell.
No, it is. It's just that, Impulse is a lot of things at the same time. You like first they are the design, then they are the label of Coltrane, then they're the label. I mean, I don't remember exactly what the connection with Verve is, but one of the guys who ran or who created Verve was at Impulse at the beginning as well. I don't remember exactly the details. So they were kind of also one of these labels that had like the cool factor.
Imagine from the get-go, and also how was you have Blue Note, you have Impulse, you have a Verve at the same time in a way. Has there been also like with the football club, you have to love Impulse and you can't like Blue Note? Has there been something like that? Have you heard about this?
Sorry, say again. I'm not sure.
Has there been a competition like fanboys, when it comes to Impulse, Blue Note? If you like those, you cannot like them. I can imagine those things. In my
view, that in the 90s, when they got this big late 90s, this big reissue program with a lot of unreleased session and all that, there were people who were going all in on Impulse for sure. like younger people, like in their late early 20s or mid 20s, who were like, oh, because they were getting into jazz. And I mean, it's one quite natural thing, like because of their history and the way they reemerged in the 90s, I think a lot of people saw, like, discovered jazz through the soul spectrum of Impulse for the longest time before they tested the waters elsewhere. And because, yeah. I mean, John Coltrane is such a strong figure that, like, it's easy to... It's the biggest tree that hides the forest behind. There's never been such a big tree hiding a forest as John Coltrane, I would say. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Creed Taylor, that's right, Jefferson. He was basically the one who was hired to create Impulse, and then he moved on to do Verve, to work at Verve, even if he was not the creator of Verve, but he was very instrumental in the Verve catalog.
Yeah, and if you look at the Verve releases when he started working there, they had the exact same cover, same quality for a while.
He totally imported that thing, for sure.
Oh, that's interesting. I wasn't aware of that. Okay, good to know. We get music.
Yeah, I think I start over here because we are into the spiritual music.
Ooh. Yes.
Wow. Wow, what is it? Let's move on. It's amazing. Keep going. Okay, but not Impulse. What is this Impulse? That's someone.
That's my third favorite record, by the way.
I got the feeling that they started to do those more free jazz and spiritual things, and they got Pharoah Sanders, and then they got into Sun Ra because he's also been independent until at the time.
So, are there more Sun Ra releases on Impulse? And when did it happen that he was there?
It happened in 72, 73, 74.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I can show you, there's 8-9 releases on Impulse.
Bird Eye.
It's quite interesting also the level of electronic music you have in this, which is something that was also something that Bob Steele was a big supporter of.
Okay.
We'll talk about that too.
Nice, very nice. Thank you. I wasn't aware that it, I knew it, that it's way more than one, but I wasn't aware that it's that many Sun Ra on Impulse. And I can imagine, Thomas, that those are not that crazy expensive like other Sun Ras, right? Or are those not that expensive, not in this crazy?
but they're not easy to find. You don't see them that often. Yeah, of course.
You know, all of those are not. It's strange. Even when you say the Max Roach is not that expensive, I agree. It's you're probably totally right, Stunty. But finding an VG Plus on near mint, it's not that you drive into the city and buy one.
No, but if you look, you find it. It's not.
Yeah, you have to search, but you never know when it's going to happen.
Well, if you go to Den Bosch, you know it's going to happen.
That's okay. We will see.
The collectors always pick them up, so they will disappear from them. But the feeling is also that it gets more and more difficult. So, and that's the feeling I got. The price will be higher because finding a near mint copy is nearly impossible. You might find a Stella, but it's they never sold anything before, and they say it's a near mint. It's difficult to find a near mint copy and from a good seller. And they're not that expensive when they're low quality, but when it's getting difficult to find a near mint, normally it indicates that the prices will keep on going up.
Yeah, you are the man who finds all of those at garage sales. Gratulation. Well,
no, but it is actually true. You used to find them like in the other places. Because there was not a normal distribution for them.
Yeah, I agree. You can find those, but I would not recommend go to garage sales to find Sunrise.
Yeah, no.
You do not recommend them.
It's funny because we're turning around like sharks around Coltrane, John, but we've talked about Archie Shepp, Taro Sanders, and we kind of mentioned Alice, which both Thomas and I think this is one of the top five Impulse releases in the whole catalog.
And okay, it Tom is pairing an armful of records. It is with him, right? Yeah.
This has Rashid Ali on drums, Pharoah Sanders, Jimmy Garrison. Yeah, it's quite minimal in a way, which is, and the music has a sort of minimalism as well that I really, really enjoy. And it's quite different, I would say, from her other records, even if there's obviously still like a connection. But she plays the harp, the piano, and it's absolutely like it's spiritual jazz in the deepest possible fashion, in my opinion. And Thomas is playing it right now. And just a little note to our friend Dave: Inner Sleeves, Impulse Inner Sleeves.
Yeah.
This.
Thomas, is this true? You have a minty guitar with no ring wear?
Was that the one before?
He needs a number, Billy Bob. Billy Bob. Give us the number.
Give us the number. I can show you because Alice Coltrane is also, I think, my favorite on Impulse.
Okay.
And the first one was together with John Coltrane called Cosmic Music. This is a reissue. They did on their own label. It was put up for John Coltrane's own independent label.
But, it was a very famous purple, black and white cover. like a paste on like the original private press that goes for a lot of money. Finding like a real VG Plus copy of the original. Do you have any, Thomas?
Yeah, I do.
I have the number. Sorry to interrupt, but I have the number of the Ptah. 9196. 9196. Okay, he's the brain is working. You know, he will find it. It's so funny how we differently process, right? Our record knowledge in a way.
Oh, I guess I'm seeing a record from last week after I left the Alfie soundtrack. I love that one.
Yeah, there it is. Yeah, that's wonderful. I agree. Yeah, while Thomas is searching for it, we still haven't gotten into the importance of those reissue series and the role they play also for the original label. I'm under the impression they do two important things. First, they get them back on the page in a way for a lot of people, and secondly, they also provide us with copies of records that are not so easy to get. You know, I mean, A Love Supreme, or here, I have it here, the ballads. It's not an easy to get record.
It's not easy if you don't go to independent record stores, which is the majority of people. It's back then, I would say these records were kind of easy to find if you were looking for them. But
at some point, we have to accept the fact that we are not back then anymore.
But I'm saying when these reissue program, Michael, when the reissue program started, when was that for this vinyl that you started to buy? That was like 7-8 years ago at least.
No, Ostanti, no. The Acoustic Sound series, 2-3 years?
Only?
Yeah.
Okay.
I have my channel for years, and it was not within the first year. I already knew that when it came out. I think I would say 2.5 years.
Wow.
Don't forget, for example, Tone Poets was earlier. So it's not that long, and at that point, those records in a very good shape has already been very, very difficult to get in some cases.
So I guess, wasn't there another label that did the Impulse reissues before that? Or maybe it was Impulse themselves.
No. And they did it usually digital. Remember this horrible... Yeah. That's true. In the mid-90s. But that was then again also when I started back then.
And I remember like most of the back in the mid-90s, the Impulse records, you would find them if you would put the word easy. I'm agreeing with you that like most people who discover Impulse and jazz in the 90s, 2000s, it's because of these reissues that you can find in, you know, in France, that would be the Fnac. I don't know what the equivalent would be in Germany. But
no equivalent, because Fnac is very special because you get records and books. Yeah. I think this is a Fnac only thing. No.
Maybe you might be correct. No, HMV. HMV, you get both as well.
But don't forget, please. I know it's hard, and it's hard to accept, but also the 90s are 30 years ago.
No, but I'm not saying, I'm just saying that for most people, even now, it's more convenient to go to these big chains or now Amazon.
So, of course,
these records will be more easy to get that way. But if you...
Convenient. Nowadays, you can go to Amazon.
I'm just saying that the people who are used to go to second-hand record stores, up until fairly recently, you could find most of them. Salut, Romuald. which is, I fully acknowledge that it's not the majority of people who buy records.
Yes, true. Thomas has prepared something. I see a stack of records at his knees.
But I was just wondering, Thomas, how much is that record worth these days?
I actually don't know.
Okay.
I would say, I will guess around 150 and 50,000. The one he asked for, it's
put it in the Claudio, then it will be even better.
Yeah, the cover.
No, don't use it for the cover. Trust me on this one.
And it's called around 10 records for record show. That was this one.
Inner, yeah, show the inner once more.
I open it up.
Yeah, please. That's nice. Great quality.
Understood.
Fantastic jacket, huh?
But Billy Bob must be disappointed because there's some ring wear on the cover. He was he was saying that he was sure that you had a cover without ring wear.
I don't see ring wear there. Ah,
yeah, there
okay.
Is. Yeah.
Bottom.
Give me 5 minutes more.
One of the 10 copies.
I had 2 copies. The other one might be much worse. Mm-hmm.
So true.
Um, I think we have seen ABC Impulse.
Of course, well, ABC owned Impulse from 62, so that would be difficult to...
Thomas, maybe now it's an interesting time to answer one question. So we will have those Impulse records we see at the wall. What other titles will we see within the next day at the OBC shop? You have prepared some you can show? Maybe show some so that people can get an idea.
Maybe some are already put up.
Mm-hmm.
This one, I think it's already sold.
Yeah, this is gone, yeah. Ah, McCoy China, cool. Just, ah. I don't know that one.
It's a Lucky Tom's of this. It's a later one. It's when you get it to, it's 9,307.
Okay.
So it's really 307.
Yeah. Jimmy Carter. Okay. So quite some. That's good. Ah, more. Okay, there are more. Ah, cool. Yusuf Lateef, nice. Coltrane, okay. Salt and Pepper. Ah, this one. That's good. Yeah, wonderful. That's wonderful. More, okay. Okay, here we go. Coltrane. Dizzy Gillespie. Keith Jarrett. Keith Jarrett is one on the input. Yeah.
And later on inputs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What is this? I barely can see that.
It's Freddie Hubbard.
Freddie Hubbard, okay.
And this is how the inner sleeve looked at some point.
Nice. Yeah, the boy. Johnny Hartman, that's... Santi, don't listen now, but this is a wonderful record, that Johnny. I have the reissue. I so love his singing. So love. It's so beautiful. So beautiful. This guy. Amazing. Yeah.
And,
here's a question from Ralph Kozak. What about the unfortunate Rainbow MCA Impulse releases? Same nice outer jacket with crappy non-impulse label. I don't know about this. Do you, Stunty, or do you, Thomas?
Yes.
Yeah, they changed the label a few times, so it's not like it's... Mm-hmm. The first one, it looked...
Is it like this comment was like religious integrism?
Okay. Why?
Because it's fetishism about like certain aspects of the design and all that, and I understand that. Huh?
And the first one looks like this.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then they changed it in 1967.
Yeah.
To the one with the ABC Impulse, the one we just, they changed it to this.
Okay.
And then they changed it to the
first one. Okay.
See, I rest my case, but I agree with him.
And it changes to this one.
Okay. Okay. And, I get it now.
In between, there's a lot of different things. It's I don't even think that I can. I'm 100% in hold of it because every year, every release has the different ones. And if you need to have a first issue of this record.
Yeah. Can you show the spine of Love Supreme? No, the spine, the back, not the spine. Because it's not, or it's white. White and black. Why?
But if you see here on this, this one is a first issue.
Mm-hmm.
Michael, it's not the only one.
Wait a second. So it's 77A, or what is the letter next to the 77A?
77A.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's, if you look it up, it is a first release. But if you need the first release, you need to have a...
This is quite interesting now, and but there is...
It looks like this.
Without the A, right? Yeah. Yeah.
Without the A in the end.
Yeah.
But it's not a system that goes through the all the records.
Mm.
But in this, this is the Coltrane was released number 77.
Yeah.
So around that time, they had this... I'm not sure if it's... Yeah.
If you're really OCD, then you will go crazy because that's so. This one that we show also white, kind of white.
Okay, here we go. I hate it now.
And also, the colors of the label variate. Like Thomas was showing ones that were really red, some were orange, some were pale orange. And then, if you want to really go crazy, go to the 7 inches because the design on the labels of the 7 inches is all over the place as well.
I won't do that, by the way. I won't. Yeah, so this is A Love Supreme, which
so that
is...
means we're getting into John Coltrane now.
No, why not? Why not?
If you see, like here, you have it's in on the cover, it says A77.
77, right?
Which should be AS because on the label, on the label,
you have AS. Oh my god. Yeah, yeah, okay. And are you sure that there are no stickers with AS? Are you sure?
No, maybe I'm not sure. There should be. There should be. I don't have here.
So what's your favorite Coltrane album, Thomas?
Custom Today. Music.
Okay. All right. What's mine has the same issue. It's a stereo, but there's no S on it. And Michael disagree with me, but like by far my favorite one is obviously this one.
Ascension.
You hear the tone of Michael's voice?
Yeah, because it's so obvious. You have to be a little bit more surprised. No, I'm kidding.
No, but it's
honestly, it's a wonderful cover. It's and the way they write this ascension in this colors, this is, but this record is more of an exorcism than music.
See what I'm dealing with. Mm-hmm. But it's also one of these records that is really exciting because there's two versions of that record, two mm-hmm. different recordings. There is Ascension 1 and Ascension 2. Mm-hmm. I have the other one up there. Because Coltrane was not happy. It's not that it's bad, but he preferred another take. So they actually rushed out a second version of it with a different recording of the same session, the same tracks.
Oh, that's and interesting.
Both are really...
How do you distinguish those, Dante?
Oh, it's like you have... let me show...
Yeah, that's Christopher. That's really free. I agree. That's really free.
Oh no, not on this one. But yeah, normally you have you will have like an indication that it's Ascension 2. But on this, it doesn't because this is the British pressing.
Justin Peters suggests a different matrix info, probably.
No, there is a way on the cover to figure it out. But yeah, but this is the original UK pressing of it, which is...
EMI.
Yeah. With the fold... cover that Dave loves as well.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very good pressing, I must say. I mean, it's a mono, this one, but
I can imagine those EMI pressings should be fantastic. I mean, they've got into them very deeply, and it makes total sense that they are very, very good for sure.
But for me, it's I agree completely that it's extremely free, but it's you just have to reach one point and suddenly it becomes like, okay, this is what Coltrane is about. This is Coltrane in his most, at his most uncivilized,
Whatever, but I think I get your point. But a few years later he died, right? That is not that far away from his death.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Might that be connected? And I'm not making a joke here, because some people say that he was aware of it and that was his exorcism.
No, he had addictions for a long time already. He didn't come like that. I don't think so. I would actually argue the opposite. Mm-hmm. And if we were to use the word you used, exorcism, then that would be like an attempt to survive, to do that,
To go, to really don't care and just go for it. And that's what this record is all about for me.
Coltrane had a lot of pressure on himself. He put it like, one of my issues with Coltrane, that like you and I have talked about it, I've never discussed that with Thomas, but for me, jazz is about playing together. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And, and Coltrane's music has something quite unique in my opinion. You're welcome to disagree, but that's in a positive and negative way. He has an ego. Like the way he creates his bands, like he needs, or that's how I perceive it, he needs the people to play for him rather than with him. When you learn about the story of Steve Coon, who became the first pianist of the John Coltrane band, because McCoy Tyner was under contract, so he couldn't get McCoy Tyner. Like, that destroyed Steve Coon's career up until the early 70s, because he was so traumatized by the way he was treated by Coltrane. Like, as soon as McCoy Tyner was available, like, okay, you're out and all that. Like, he felt like he was really used rather than any other experience he had had in jazz live playing before. And I've read other people say not exactly the same, but some stuff going in that direction. But I don't even need to read people saying that, because that's how I felt when I listened to his music first. And it was kind of a cognitive dissonance for me, because of my expectations from listening to jazz music, also having been fortunate enough to experience jazz live quite an early age in clubs in Paris. So, of course, when you discover jazz with John Coltrane and you don't have another perspective, I can totally understand that you wouldn't have that issue. For me, I was spoiled that way.
Interesting take. Thanks for sharing. Thomas, you prepared something for us?
Yeah. This one, I think it's doesn't sound like anything else on Impulse.
I still wasn't aware of this record. Thanks for sharing this. This is amazing. Yeah, right. Wonderful.
It's one of the very last Bob Steele productions.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, you know the years, don't you?
67, I think, yeah.
Can you give us a little more? Let's get a little more of it. This is really, really cool. Been sampled?
Yeah, I think Black Sheep sampled this one.
Okay. So, seeking a thread, Dom, you mentioned that this has been a formerly cheap record, now insane. Thomas,
you can't find it. You can't find originals of that one.
How much is an original of this one, Thomas? You know that?
I know it's got expensive.
If you have a clean copy of that, if you find for $200 a copy of that, you should take it.
So that means on the real market it's over 1,000. Wow.
No. But it's just that it's,
say 200.
No. I'm telling you, it's because as Dom was saying, it was like a cheap, very cheap record. But now, it's more that you can't find it. So someone asking 200 and it's a clean copy, you should take it. Yeah. It's a bit expensive, but you can't find it, so.
Yes, I did that, but that is off topic and a secret.
I will look it up here.
You're right, Sean, you're right. You have that record, Stunty? Because I wouldn't be surprised.
I have it, but I don't have the. I have the original Japanese pressing of that. Like that's the one I found.
So there is, but the first pressing, the original, is an US pressing, and you found a Japanese one.
Yeah, right? Which came out at the same time, but it's an ABC Impulse.
There are copies, but clean copies.
I will put one up on the OBC.
Oh, okay. Wow, really? I buy it.
But it will only be there. It will be there for a short time. Then I take it off again because I have I have two copies. The one I'm playing is like a VG copy. It has some scratches, but play good. And then I have this one.
Wow.
A sealed copy.
A sealed copy. Yeah. A first pressing seal.
First pressing sealed copy.
Wow.
Okay. Of the mono sealed copy.
That's tempting.
Yeah, okay. Show me your wallet. Wow. I don't know, but I'll put it up. It's I love this record, but I don't need two copies, and I hate a steel copy. But
Wow, that's amazing. Cool.
Is it the mono one or the stereo?
Right, Manfred.
It's the mono one.
Are there two versions?
That's the one you can't find, if I remember correctly.
Okay.
You can see it's up here.
It's difficult with the glare.
No, it's stereo. It's a stereo one. It says stereo.
It says A, not AS. So it's the mono one.
Yeah, good.
A mono copy. You can't find a mono copy.
That's what my experience as well.
So there is no monocopy at all, okay? No, we don't auction. We don't do auction.
First man, get it. But it's a good record. But it, and I think it's his best record, Tom Scott. I think it's.
That was amazing, and I think that Justin Peters was correct with the Jefferson Airplane comment.
No? In the beginning when he heard it.
Wait a second. Come again?
Yeah. Do you know Tom Scott before this?
You mean the director, right?
No, the musician here.
No. I always, when you say Tom Scott, I always say the director. Ridley Scott's part. Yeah, I know.
Okay. Because like for people who would listen to this record and who don't know who he is, I would always like ask, guess which instrument he's playing on it, which in a way is obvious. But yeah.
Just say it.
Oh, no, he's a saxophone player, yeah. Because like to have like a saxophone on that kind of music is kind of unusual.
I mean, how he lies down in the flowers. Oh my God, that's so wonderful. The cover art is amazing too. It's almost, it's already a little bit hippie culture, right?
Yeah, it's the only one on the Impulse that looked like this.
Yeah.
Has it an orange spine in the correct orange?
The cap, orange. It might be a bit more, orange.
It's a little red. It look on my screen, it looks a little red, but hey, come on. Who cares?
Fuchsia, Michael.
Billy Bob, 1976, is asking, when are we getting into John Klemmer?
Well, first, we're getting into Charlie Hayden, the Liberation Orchestra. This one is still, I think this one is still cheap, fortunately. But look at the talent in this.
Carla Bley, ECM, later ECM, yeah. Featuring Gatto Barbieri, Don Cherry, Dewey Redman, Roswell Rudd, Sam Brown. I'm most familiar with Carla Bley.
Well, and look at this design.
Yeah, wonderful.
But this came out after Bob Thiel had left.
And look at the design. Quite different, Stanti. Quite different.
Yeah, right? Absolutely.
Oh my God! What are you showing us? That's a nightmare.
And Thomas, I wasn't thinking about it, but that's the time when by that time all Impulse releases are ABC. Releases on the cover as well. He told me that I didn't think about it ever before that. So when you see this, you think, oh, this is a reissue or a later press. No, it's that's how it came out originally. And this is a record you can still find out in the wild for like $20.
Which year are we talking here, Stanti?
1971, it was released, or 72. Mm-hmm. Like Thomas knew it by heart when.
Oh, he knows the number, but not the year.
No, for this one, he knew it's 72. Yeah.
And they changed in the 67. I haven't put it up, but this John Klemmer will be up on the OBC as well.
Nice. So here is your answer, Billy Bob.
And it's you can see what? This is how they look when it's a promo copy.
It's a promo, okay. Yeah. Nice.
But it looks like looks like the Sun Ra release we had.
Yeah,
I did a few in this look, which I really like as well, but it doesn't look like anything like Impulse.
It's kind of in between the Sun Ra and the Alice Coltrane.
It is, yeah.
Thomas, do you have a Dom is looking for this Hayden in a pristine shape? You have that?
I can't remember what it is.
The one Stunty just showed, this one.
Oh, what number is it?
Yeah, it's 9183, I believe. 91. Yeah.
Yeah. Of course, he has his organizations, and I would do the same, by the way. Imagine this amount of records. I mean, that makes total sense. See, I would have been surprised if not. If you have a spare copy, put one up at the OBC for Dom. Because, Dom, don't be afraid. We have free shipping at the OBC, also to America, so no shipping fees.
I put it aside and look for one more. I think I have one more.
Okay. Okay, where are we now?
Maybe back.
Oh, that's always the best part of it.
Should be that. Yeah, let's get this.
I knew that you liked that hint. I knew that you liked that.
Yeah, I don't know what it is, but the artwork, everything makes this one come.
But this is a Stunty. Don't disappoint me now. This is a Stunty record. Come on. You have to like
it. No, I hate it.
You are a terrible person.
I don't hate it, but for me it's too. No, it's Ahmad Jamal is not for me. I've never heard a record of him that I felt like, oh, okay. Wow, I'm excited about him. It's too, for my taste, it's a bit too civilized in a way, too acceptable in a way.
Wonderful.
I think I like it a lot because it's it has, for me, it has its own personality. It's the only one sounding like this. It's the only one who has a color work that I think like is like the most beautiful under all of the inputs. Mm. Quality is not like the glossy ones, but it's, but the artwork I really, really like.
Which year is this? It's also a little later one, right? It's a 9,000 something release.
The number is 9,194.
Okay.
It will be around 71,
72, I think. 72, right? Yeah, yeah. You know, when we have Blue Note, it almost looks like that those artists haven't been allowed to do records on other labels, at least for a certain time. Only Blue Note, Blue Note only. Do we have the same with Impulse, Dante?
Sorry, I was distracted. Say again.
When it comes to Blue Note, it almost looks like we have certain artists that are under contract. They are only allowed to put out records over it. Do we have the same with Impulse?
Well, yes, but not in the same sense. For them, they wanted it. It was like with Blue Note and Prestige, it was more like the strict thing, but for the kind of music that there, I guess it was more like, oh, they found a home on Impulse. It was not,
because so also, is it safe to say when I say that a certain kind of character of musicians, a new, a more modern approach, also when it comes to the way they stood with the label? Is that correct?
Well, at least like when Bob Thiel was the art director, for sure. After that, as well, I guess. But I don't know exactly the history. But what I remember is, yes, let's put it that way. Alice Coltrane putting out all these records in the 70s, 80s, who else would put out that kind of music back then? Huh? Like it was not like she had a thousand opportunities.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, interesting. How successful were those records at the time?
By the early mid 70s, not that successful.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They were more,
which also means for us collectors that there are not that many copies out there.
No, they still did because they had like a big distribution deal. So
okay,
the records were widely available for the most part. Not every single one, of mm-hmm. course, but which is why, as a few people in the chat has said, like up until fairly recently, you could find most of these records for a normal price.
Okay, if you know that, maybe this is too much to ask, but let's say Verve does 20,000, then Impulse does 5,000 copies. Is that the regions we are talking here?
I think it would be closer to each other.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thomas, when you look like this, you have prepared something.
I don't know.
No, I said when you look like this, I've learned you have prepared something for us.
I have nothing.
Damn it. See, oh, I tried, and then you say, "I no records today, that's it." This is a unbelievable tour.
I like the artwork here as well. I think.
Yeah.
Wonderful. This is a Mingus highlight for me.
Yeah, I think it's the best Mingus on the input.
Impulse.
Yeah, but I think.
Yeah, I agree. I agree, Dom. This is wonderful. Wow.
I'm not a big fan of my favorite
jazz album ever. See? Wow.
I'm really not a big fan of Mingus, but this album I really love.
Oh, you do? You like it? Okay, great.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, it's cool. And it's funny because it has a mark on top here.
What does it say? It's something with an M.
It says Magasin. It's
okay.
It's a big, you cannot say supermarket, but a place where they have all kind of clothes and labels and furniture and everything and restaurants. A really nice house and most famous one in Copenhagen. But at some point they were selling records.
Okay.
And I don't think they had so huge success with the records. So like 10 years ago, somebody found in the back of the magazine a lot of records. Yeah.
Oh, okay. And, oh, wow. That was a happy man who found those.
Yeah, the reason why they didn't sell, I think, it was because they had a really good guy who bought the records for magazine. So there was a lot of releases that nobody listened to in the 70s, 60s.
Not quite. Breakfast, Stanti says that and he thinks that. Listen, 90% of the time you can listen to Stanti and trust him. Not always. When it comes to Mingus, obviously not.
You can trust me that I'm not a big fan of Mingus.
Yeah.
Well, I won't lie.
That's the most important thing.
Oh, but yeah. And also a nice reissue of it.
What reissue is this?
It's on Acoustic Sound, I think.
They put out two of those, and yeah, wonderful, amazing. Yeah. Yeah. The Mingus is also on Impulse, right? Yes, I think it is. And then there is a third one. I now see the jacket, but I don't remember the title. That's very well put. Exactly. Trust his recommendations. Not always his perfectly put. Oh, then there is a fourth, because I remember. Yeah. Yeah. Right.
I'm just looking them up, so.
Welcome to the club, Anthony. Just say it several times and everybody knows what record you are talking about, Justin. It's as easy as this.
I think he did it.
Go.
Sorry?
No, I'm waiting for Thomas. Oh, you have a spare one. That's good. That's a good sign.
It's the mono and the stereo.
Ah, okay. It's almost a spare one. Almost a spare
one. Close to a spare
one. Yeah, right, Clive. It's Mingy. That's nice.
Yeah, I think there is three releases on there. On inputs that I can see here. He did one on Atlantic in between.
Okay. The acoustic sounds are amazing, I agree. Yeah. But although I have to say, Raph, I've never compared them to an original, so I'm always careful nowadays before I did that.
You have the chance now to compare to a Stereo Moment.
Oh, that's good. That's good to know. Yeah, Mingus, what an amazing artist. I mean, hey. So quite some names on that label. But I think Jason Rojas is under the impression that we forgot one, at least so far, and that's Gabor Szabo, or Szabo.
He did, but he also did quite a few on Flying Dutchman.
Mm-hmm. Which would have been the bridge to the thing. Yeah. Maybe Stunty. Maybe this is a good time. When Brad Thiele left Impulse, what did he do?
Well, he's done quite a few labels till he died, but the big one after Impulse is Flying Dutchman, and which released Gil Scott Heron, Gato Barberi, John Appleton, and like Gabor Szabo, and also some of his own music. One of my absolute favorite records ever. Not just the music, but the record itself, the concept, the project, the Bob Thiele Emergency, which it's a double album. As you can see, the design, there's already a sort of continuity.
Yeah, but more funky in a way. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
A little more. He gave it a little notch. Love it.
And this is like an amazing big band featuring Ornette Coleman, Bob Thiele, Elvin Jones, Jimmy Gillespie, lots of people. But what's incredible about it is the fourth side, which is like a 15-20 minute long sound collage, like a political music concrete, experimental collage he did with Don Cherry, if I remember correctly, or Don Cherry is involved in some capacity.
When I hear what you just said, I'm totally not surprised that you like it. Huh?
Oh yeah, yeah. You have also Tom Scott is on this, but I mean, just the design. This you see, there's this kind of like post 68, because what happened.
It's almost like Lemmy Caution, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah, but I mean 68 as the political, you know, May 68, like this kind of, you know, when you do like a graffiti in the street, political graffiti. And
maybe be so nice and show the logo a little closer, because the logo is also worth mentioning, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You were asking me earlier why he... I don't know why he shows the name. The Flying Dutchman is a popular figure in the 60s with comic books, movies, etc. But
and operas, by the way.
Yeah. Yeah. but yeah. Oh yeah. When you see here, like the Kennedys, like all the dead, the people who were killed.
Yeah, exactly. Martin Luther King.
And. Yeah, and what's his name? The Black Panther.
Can you do a Thomas Busk for us and show some of those?
Me? Record? Oh, well, one of my favorites is this one, which is also like getting into electronic music, as this is John Appleton, who is one of the inventors, developers of the synclavier. And so this is a showcase of the synclavier called
the MCC. I mean, if you see those jackets, Dante, it's so obvious. Sorry for interrupting.
Yeah.
Sorry. It's so obvious that it's connected to Impulse.
Yeah.
It's so obvious. But in a very, very good way. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And funny thing is that there's another John Appleton record on that label with Don Cherry. I think there's also a 7-inch of this.
You have the Carter Bradford records on the Flying Dutchman?
The which one?
The Carter Bradford records.
No, I don't have that one. No. But sorry, Michael.
No, that's not a problem at all. Damn, that's sexy somehow. You have that catsuit, Santi?
Sorry?
You have that catsuit?
I wish I had. Yeah, I would.
Next week, you put it on?
If you find it and give it to me, I'll wear it during the stream.
You know, you would. I know you would.
I would, absolutely. There's a bunch of really, really good Gâteau Barbieri albums also on Flying Dutchman. This one is really amazing.
So we are still talking about an American label, right? This is quite impressive. I mean, wow, a beautiful logo, label too.
Design. But also, as you see, like the gatefold was like very, of course, there's differences, but like the over the years, Impulse had, like, as we saw, like lots of differences. For me, it is like if you're in a big Impulse fan, you have to follow Flying Dutchman because it's basically a natural extension. Even if Impulse kept releasing stuff after 68, this is really like the vision, the continuity.
What years are we talking about when we talk about the Flying Dutchman label?
68 to about 84, I believe.
It
doesn't have that big of a catalog. Like, I mean, like like Thomas was saying, 4,000 releases on Impulse. I think it would be between 500 and 600 on Flying Dutchman, because there were independent.
How is it with the availability of those, Stunting?
Well, I would say like Impulse 5-6 years ago.
Really? Okay.
Yeah.
So it's really worth getting into it.
Yeah, because most of the musicians are still alive.
Mm-hmm.
Not Don Cherry, not Bob Teal, but like some of these records now you may have to pay between like 50, 80, 85 euros for them, but I don't know of any on the catalog.
200, okay.
Yeah, no, there is, of course, the Gil Scott Heron and the Horace Tapp Scott that all worth a little more.
Right. The Gil Scott Heron is on Flying Dutchman.
Yeah, absolutely.
Exactly. I forgot. See my brain. Thomas, you have a take on the Flying Dutchman too?
Yeah, a funny thing is that we showed the cover because they're really nice, but because when the Bob Chile left the Impulse started to look like this.
Yeah.
No idea, feel like nothing. So Impulse become boring, and then they moved everything to Flying Dutchman.
So then you can see how connected things are often to one person, right? It's always, not always, but so often the case. And thanks for Stunty to putting this emphasis on this person. I mean, this is the best proof of how big his influence has been on this label. And thanks, Thomas, for showing what happened after he left. Flying Dutchman. Here we go. Yeah, yeah.
You can see the logo is down there.
Yeah.
So that's I think. If you check the albums, it will be around 150 releases that is worth collecting, and you can still get a lot of them for 5 to 10 euro. So that's why it's interesting. But some of them, like this one, might be 150 in a good condition.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But you can Jill Scott Heron, Funk and Soul, fantastic funk and soul. So that means on the Flying Dutchman, we have a larger variety of music genres than on Impulse.
They started to move more over to soul.
Okay.
So and
pure electronic music, like the is pure electronic avant-garde music, but the wonderful thing is that it actually feels at home on that label when you listen to it, because that record came before. So it paved the way, and it's not any kind of electronic music. It's something that it connects with this. And which is funny, because when you look at that cover, you would never think that this
never ever more in the direction of Herb Alpert than what you are describing.
Yeah, yeah. Unless you look at the back cover. But it's like, there's one record that, from Impulse, that I wanted to just mention quickly because of the back cover. And the front cover and back cover. Oh, yeah.
I just say this is a Latin record.
Yeah.
So it's a different thing than Impulse.
Yeah, this one, John Coltrane, Archie Shepp.
Yeah.
Archie Shepp, John Coltrane.
See?
It's just simple. Nothing special, but I love it. This is the
kind of idea. And especially what you just said a few minutes ago about John Coltrane. I mean, hey, see, he could do it.
This is a wonderful record, by the way. Yeah.
Thomas, you wanted to show or say something?
That's also on Flying Dutchman. So, Andy Davis.
This is a record. When you see this jacket, I would buy it immediately if the price is not insane. You see the jacket that this is an interesting record, in my opinion.
Yes, but she's not a singer, but she does sing, but she was like a freedom fighter. So.
If you want to play something of those, Thomas, give us an impression if you like.
Okay, I choose a little bit where it's more
interesting. Yeah, take your time. I go back to Stunty and the Flying Dutchman label. So, you are more into the Flying Dutchman. Oh, yeah, we are already there. Sorry. I'm talking.
Yeah, that's Stone Cold classic. That one got sampled so much as well.
Okay.
I just saw the Star East one. That's one of my favorites. I think when I run through the Flying Dutchman, it could be nice to do an evening just with Flying Dutchman, because there's a lot of nice tracks.
That Lonely Smith record, I think, it's from 75. It sounds like a Mowax record from 20 years later.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we put Flying Dutchman on the list, I think, huh? Let's put it on the list.
And then
we will see Stunty in his studio, and he also can put up some of those. At least I hope.
Maybe, yeah.
Oh, that was cool. So, Thomas, any things that we haven't covered yet? Any things on the Impulse label that you want to show us, that you want to present us or play to us, or have we done the things?
A lot of the good artists that are on Impulse, but I can't remember right now. But
of course.
We look through what I take aside.
Yeah. So I hope that in the last 130 minutes we gave you,
I'll say one we forgot. Mr. Latif, he's also there.
Okay. I think you're right, and I think we should get into this one. If you want to play something for us, Yusuf Latif. Yeah.
I forgot one fellow Sanders. This is his first one.
Okay. But I think it's safe to say that you presented us once more, like always, an unbelievable collection of originals and records. Thomas, you are one of a kind. I think that's safe to say. And we will move on. Yeah. And Thomas, thank you so much. Amazing 2 hours and 15 minutes. Stanti. Thank you also so much. And I have to give you something to you. It doesn't matter if we do something that you're into wholeheartedly or just on the side, like with the Impulse label. Stanti, your knowledge is unbelievable.
Well, as you say, everything is connected. So,
the OBC, the Original Buyers Club Impulse T-shirt of the evening. Yeah.
The further you go down the rabbit hole of music in general, the more you can connect things with each other.
It's not only in music, it's with all things. You're totally right. Okay, thank you all so much, and we see us next week.
And I have a track to finish up with. Just listen to
this. Oh, that's great.
While we go away. It's while crazy. We go away. He's playing a flute and singing at the same time. Why we go away, just listen to
Justin Peters, that's one question. Do the shirts determine the stream topic, or is it the other way?
No. The shirts decides everything.
Exactly. And Dom, I hope you finally join next week. I sent you an email every week until you join.